There's nothing like Minnesota high school football. Football nights are special. It's about the players, the fans.
Let's go!
The communities. Prep Preview is here to set the stage each week. Dig into the key rivalries, the unique stories, the players to watch, and break down what it all means. The KARE TV Prep Preview on YouTube starts now.
Hi, everybody. Week 6 of the Minnesota high school football season. We're into October. Now each game matters a little bit more, and the weather will start to become a factor as well as it was last Friday, and we're going to talk about all that in a second. Welcome to Prep Preview on YouTube. I'm Randy Shaver, along with Greg Norkus, who just got here from the Bahamas or someplace warm, and we're covering high school football for games played on October 5th, 6th, and 7th of this week. Crazy Friday last week. About as crazy as the shirt you have on. I've never seen a Friday night where we've covered high school football where we didn't know any of the finals. We didn't know what was happening because games were suspended because of lightning
weather
and the weather.
Was a factor.
It definitely was a factor, but we got through it. A lot of games were finished on Saturday. Some even finished on Monday, but we get through week 5.
Weather was a factor. It's going to be talked about in this show for a little bit. Let's start with this shirt. First of all, it's a collared shirt.
Yes, it is.
Thank you very much. I just want to let you know that our viewers care. One viewer in particular, who's a big fan of this show.
Your dad?
Yes, Norb Norkus. How'd you guess? He's concerned about you in the cold weather, and now that we are officially in the cold weather season, he got me this shirt to kind of shock you back into happy, warm weather happiness.
Okay, what's the purpose of what we have?
Well, you might think, because this shirt has a flamingo on it, that the flamingo theme on the desk would be because of the shirt.
Okay.
It's completely independent of that. The flamingos are stress balls, and you can crush them, and they come back to life. They're for stress and anxiety.
Which obviously you have a lot of.
If this town could get a quarterback that could get out of the pocket and not stand there like a statue. Okay.
That's actually not high school football conversation.
Well, I'm ready now.
Save that for US
I'm
Bank.
I'm ready now.
Okay.
I'm ready.
Oh, boy. Biggest football game of the week is on Thursday night, October 5th in Class 6A. Number 1 Eden Prairie travels to number 3 Minnetonka. Both are undefeated. The Skippers beat Shakopee in a weather-delayed game on Friday night to remain unbeaten, despite the fact they had 7 starters out of the lineup because of injuries, obviously. Head coach Mark Ash has Minnetonka rolling, and I talked with Mark and EP head coach Mike Grant. Minnetonka star quarterback Milo Spasovic helped lead the Skippers to an impressive 4-0 start to the season. But in the second half of this win over Prior Lake, Spasovic tore his ACL and his season was over.
First of all, you feel terrible for the kid. You know, he's worked so hard. He had an ACL as a sophomore. He worked hard to get back for his junior year, and then just so much hard work that went into it, and it's hard to see him on the sideline.
Every injury has a ripple effect, and Minnetonka is adjusting with a new quarterback and a tall task. Number 1 ranked Eden Prairie comes to town Thursday night, October 5th.
They're just so good at what they do. I don't think there's any secrets. They just execute at such a high level. And from our perspective, we've told our kids we're going to treat every week the same. We're going to go out and play to the best of our ability, whether we're playing the 32nd ranked team in 6A or the number 1 ranked team in 6A. So I think the kids have really bought into that, and that's why we've been consistent.
We've got 2 really good D-tackle. Mosane is a D-tackle that is 6'4", 6'5", about 260. And then Dennis Rahuski is 6'6", 265. So when you put those 3 in the middle there and are playing, we've got 3 really D1 type athletes in that spot. So our D-line is pretty good. And we've got some injuries on kids that we think are really good that haven't played yet. So I think that's really one of our strengths on defense, is just that size and physicality.
How do you see the trenches? Will it be the deciding factor on Thursday?
100%. They have a big, strong offensive line. We feel like our defensive line is one of the best they're going to see, and we'll find out on Thursday night. We feel like our old line has been the most consistent part of our team. That's why we've been able to, you know, bridge these two wins with Milos while our young quarterback gets acclimated to the game. So I think it's going to be a battle up front.
So you heard Mike Grant talk about three guys on that defensive line. The other player that he didn't mention is Will Sather, who's their offensive center. So they do have three guys, and Sather's been playing
both ways.
Yeah, for them. Handful of games on Thursday night. Here are some of them. Obviously, the Eden Prairie-Minnetonka game we will cover in our sports on Thursday night at 10. Let's take a look at the latest 6A rankings that came out on Monday. Eden Prairie continues to be the unanimous number one team. All first place votes go to them. Lakeville South is number two, Minnetonka at three. Friday night, Centennial will play at Anoka. That will be our Friday night spotlight game.
I can't wait for that as our spotlight game. Centennial and Anoka may have been off the radar in 6A for some, but both should be on all radars now. I really like the tough brand of football that Centennial coach Mike Diggins has imprinted on his team. It's kind of old school physical ball, and they'll be playing in an old school field stadium with Goodrich Field in Anoka.
Yeah, we're going to talk more about that coming up in just a little bit. Of course, we're coming off a great spotlight game that was started, then stopped, and started again. Chanhassen taking on Mankato West on Friday during that weather delay, and that was a factor in this football game.
It was a factor. We're going to get to weather in a moment. First, I want to guarantee that this is a tape-free taping. I have the tape off my face now that this game is over. And for anybody that needed counseling or was so disturbed by that outfit, I apologize, but do not come to my house on Halloween. I will be tape-faced for Halloween, handing out candy to the little kids. My guess is I'm probably going to have a lot of candy left, and that's
probably
the goal.
So, yes.
That's the goal. But anyway, so to the game, Maxwell Woods was the obvious offensive threat coming into this game for Chanhassen on the ground.
Yes, for them.
But I wanted to see how and when the Storm would test the secondary of the Scarlets, and it didn't take them long to try. First play of the game, the Storm carried their wins through the air. 24-yard completion, Braden Windschuttle to Daxon Bush. The same tandem for Chan would get the first points, a 22-yard touchdown pass, Windschuttle to Bush, 7-0. Mankato West, 4th-and-2, nearly impossible to stop in these short-yarded situations. With the jumbo package they bring in, they slam quarterback Bart Makinich behind it. He gets the 2 yards, first down, which later in the drive led to a 1 yard TD plunge by Makinich, and it's a 7-7 ball game. But players storm off the field, the fans storm the exits because of a storm. Now, we had a 2 hour thunderstorm lightning delay, and Chanhassen Stadium announcer Denny Loffenberger came up with something really fun to pass the time. They streamed this game on Chanhassen Storm Athletics page on YouTube. He came up with a little game to try to keep the people on the stream. How many songs could they play that were weather-related songs? They encouraged viewers to call in with requests or social media with requests. Also tell their friends. Now keep in mind, there were 13 total people to start when this stream began with the delay. We're gonna name an artist and see if you can come up with the storm song associated with it. They did over 20, we're just gonna do 5, okay? So the first artist we have is Prince.
Purple Rain.
Yes, good job, you got it. You got Purple Rain. Okay, we got 4 more, see if you can get these.
Okay.
There's your Purple Rain.
Okay.
The next artist is Adele.
What? No idea.
What rain song or storm song does Adele sing?
No idea.
Set fire to the rain.
Okay. I didn't get that one.
You get that one.
No.
Next group, Milli Vanilli.
What? Oh, my God. What?
You don't know Milli Vanilli?
I do know Milli Vanilli.
Oh, you'll
I don't
know, this
know
song.
The song.
Come on. Blame it on the rain.
Somehow it was sung a lot better by Milli Vanilli.
I don't sing. Next song, Guns N' Roses. This was my request, by the way.
Oh, my. I don't know.
You don't
I'm
know
so
Guns
bad
N' Roses?
With music.
Okay. And the cold November rain.
Okay. Well,
okay.
Good.
One more.
Off a month, but
now, this
fine.
Is the next one is very popular. You can get this next one.
Okay.
The Weather Girls. What song do they sing associated with
I
weather?
I don't know.
It's raining, man. Oh. Hallelujah, it's raining, man. Okay, so anyway, honorable mention went to REO Speedwagon and Ride in the Storm Out.
Yes, that's a good one.
Ride in the Storm Out. Special thanks to the other press box assistants for the fun we had in this. John Gans, Bob Schaefer, Paul Palmer, and Craig Pearson with the Minnesota State High School League all participated in this. And by the way, the 13 people that started on the stream turned into over 700.
That's awesome.
Just with a rain delay,
that's
watching
awesome.
Rain and doing songs pertaining to weather.
That's
how about
awesome.
That kind of fun? Oh, by the way, the game did resume with 2:26 left in the half. The Storm were most prepared after the storm. Tyler Smith, already we know he's a great defensive player and the punter, but he also runs the ball with a nifty 19-yard gain. Then, under a minute left in the half, it's the wind again. Wind Schittle, this time a 28-yard strike to Maxwell Woods. That actually capped a 99-yard drive that only took 2 hours and 10 minutes, pre and post-storm.
Yes, amazing.
The Scarlets and Mackinich, through the air, they answer. This is going to be a 33-yard connection to Jalen Smith.
Nice play.
Yeah. The Scarlets threatened to answer. They had a first and goal at the 3, but on 3rd and goal, watch the hit by Woods. You know, he runs the ball, he catches the ball.
It's a monster hit.
Yeah, he happens to be a heck of a defender, too.
Yeah.
What a player. So Shan would end up holding there. They would drive and score after that stop, and the team with the name Storm prevails on a night with a storm delay, 21-14 the final, leaving Mankato West thunderstruck.
And that's the way it shakes out now in the 5A rankings, because Chan is now the unanimous number one team in Class 5A. Mankato West only drops 2 spots down to number 3, and rightly so. Very good football team. Rogers moves up to number 2. Alexandria is still in that top 5 as well after their big win over Brainerd.
I was curious to see if Mankato West would fall to 2 or 3. It does make sense that an undefeated Rogers team would get the 2 spot.
I vote on this, Craig, and I did not drop them down that far.
Well, and oh, by the way, these two teams are going to meet on October 18th. It's going to be a rematch of last year's 5A state semifinal game.
Well, you're thinking that they're going to meet in the section final.
No, they're going to meet on October 18th.
Oh, you're talking about Rogers.
Rogers and
you're
Mankato
talking about
West.
Rogers and Mankato West.
Rogers and Mankato West.
I thought you meant Chan.
Yes, 2 versus 3.
Chan is in the same section, though, as Mankato West.
Correct.
And so only one of those two teams will get out
can
to
get
go
out.
To state.
That's
unless it's Chaska or somebody else in that section,
right.
But
that's
more than
unfair.
Likely Mankato West or Chan has it.
Yeah.
All right. Alexandria, as I said, beat Brainerd on Friday night. Both teams at the time were ranked in the top 10 in 5A. They still are. Brainerd falling to number 9. The Warriors are led by senior quarterback Eli Holtz, who played receiver the past 2 seasons before going back to the position he loves, quarterback.
We've just found success in like all aspects of the game. Our defense is playing off our offense, and our offense is playing off our defense. So it's just been really good so far for us to get off to a good start.
How about for you? What makes you – describe yourself as a player for me. What makes you a great quarterback?
I like to get out of the pocket, make a lot of plays. I think that's my strongest suit, is just being able to get outside of the pocket and make plays. I kind of relate it to, like, basketball. I'm a point guard in basketball, so I find a lot of common themes within my basketball game and my football game. Coach Nelson gives me a lot of freedom. Like once a play breaks down, to get out of the pocket, and we do a lot of scramble drills and stuff like that. So just having that connection with my wide receivers too is a really big thing.
Describe the vibe in Brainerd right now.
Very optimistic, very upbeat. Everyone's super positive, and just like it's different than years past. It's like you finish one game and you just can't wait to go out and play the next. So I think just that excitement around our team within the community as well is a big thing. Like kids just want to play football all the time now, and everyone's super positive and super confident.
All right, the other Class 5A story this week is Sauk Rapids Rice.
Can we tie a little bit on?
Oh, sure.
Really,
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, because something really struck me there. Coach Nelson gives me a lot of freedom to get out of the pocket when the play breaks down. We practice scramble drills, getting out of the pocket. Okay.
Feel better now?
Yes.
Those poor things. They're not going to survive the show. Back to Sauk Rapids Rice. They beat the defending 5A champion Elk River to raise their record to 5-0. But this story isn't about wins and losses.
Instead, it's about what the football players and actually all athletes at Sauk Rapids do after their games.
They pitch in and they clean up. I talked with head football coach and athletic director Phil Klopicki about taking care of business after games.
So truthfully, Randy, it's what I did as a kid when, and I told you that, you know, my dad was our activities director and we grew up just doing it. We just started to recognize how powerful it was when we kept doing it. And also after varsity games, our student section is cleaning. And it kind of felt like, well, as a team now, we should do this. I mean, it's easy for us to do. You can see the impact. You can see how powerful it is in your community and how much people appreciate it. And honestly, like I get emails from other activities directors and our team might win or lose at an away site. And all of a sudden we get a message that just says, you know, it was really powerful to see your kids clean your space afterwards. And when our custodial crew or our grounds crew went over and saw it and it was already clean, they couldn't be more appreciative. So we just recognize the impact. And I don't think our kids feel like it's hard. You know, we're not asking anybody to do anything crazy, but after a game, just cleaning a little bit, honestly, what's so cool is you just kind of see kids feel good. As corny and cliched as that sounds, like typically when kids are cleaning, it doesn't feel like work. They kind of think it's funny, them and their buddies going and grabbing a garbage bag and throwing away a couple water bottles. And then what's just so cool is when it's done, it's done. I hope that they're just learning that, you know, simple acts of kindness, like really not hard, not asking you to do massive things, but doing those kind of routine things routinely is just so highly appreciated. The other piece is like, no job is too big for me. We can all do our part and we can all sacrifice to the whole. And if we do that, we can be really successful and it doesn't need to be somebody's job. You know, organizations that struggle, when you hear people say like, that's not my job, you know, that's not, they're gonna struggle. Like the goal is it's all of our jobs all the time. And hopefully kids will bite that. It's kind of like a farmer mentality. You just work until the work is done.
That's a great piece of advice. It's a great story, and it's not. We talk a lot about the life lessons that football teaches.
Yes.
That lesson right there about taking care of business after the game is over, and not, you know, making life easier for someone else who maybe that is their job, but you're making their life easier by doing that. That's just, it's such invaluable information and lessons learned.
We love this, right? We talk about it all the time. It's using the platform of football to mold lives in a positive manner. And it was a couple years ago, I remember, when Becker knocked off Hutch when Hutch was number one.
Yeah.
Coach Lundin, instead of telling this team to celebrate on Saturday, said, you're coming back at 8 a.m. on Saturday and cleaning the grounds.
I remember that.
The Sherburne County inmates are the ones that usually clean those grounds. He had the players do it. Same thing, responsibility, accountability, it's wonderful.
Phil's in his eighth year as head coach at Sauk Rapids Rice. He told me in an email on Monday following their win at Elk River that the bleachers were spotless. He said our fans and students had them clean before we were finished with our post-game conversation. That's the impact that they're having, and maybe we'll catch on at other schools as well.
That's wonderful.
Yep, our Friday night spotlight game takes us to the legendary Goodrich Field in Anoka, where the 4-1 Tornadoes host the 4-1 Centennial Cougars, both ranked in the top 10 in Class 6A. Centennial plays a physical brand of football. Their defense is tough, relentless. Their offense loves to run the football with backs Maverick Harper and Tyler Burgoon. The Cougars want to control the line of scrimmage. They want to run the clock.
You know, that offense has a pretty good back and quarterback, Daylon Cummings. He can be a handful in the running game as well.
So their only loss was to the defending state champion, Maple Grove. Anoka throws the football a lot. Junior quarterback Peyton Podani averaging over 270 yards passing per game. Their only loss of the season was also to Maple Grove. So this game Friday between Anoka and Centennial will help settle some conversation in the Metro North. Should be a lot of fun. Spotlight game is Friday night at Anoka, Centennial and the Tornadoes. Full highlights on KARE at 10:15 in the Prep Sports Extra, then 11 o'clock on cable, YouTube, KARE11.com, and KARE Plus as well.
Here's the concern.
Uh-oh. We got
a concern here.
Okay.
So last week's spotlight game, I covered a team with the name Storm.
Chanhassen.
Resulting in a storm delay.
Oh, I know where this is going.
This week in Anoka, I'm covering a team with the name Tornadoes.
Oh, no.
I would prefer
don't jinx this.
I would prefer it if we don't get a tornado delay. Are there any teams out there with, like, the name Sunshine?
No.
So me and my shirt can go there?
I don't think so. The only sunshine I know is remember the Titans, the quarterback. That's what's his nickname. That's the only one I know.
Well, right. That's not a spotlight.
That's not going to work.
Please no tornadoes.
Please no. Yeah, we don't need another weather Friday. Some games that we're watching on Friday night, other than the game we just talked about. Elk River Rogers, that game's a tackle cancer game. It's a rivalry game, but Elk River, obviously, with a 1-4 start to the season, not the same as it's been in the past, but it still will pack the stands. It'll be a great football game, no doubt about it. Cooper Jefferson, both teams are 4-1. That game being played at Bloomington Stadium should be a lot of fun. St. Thomas Academy is going to battle Apple Valley, and we're going to cover that Chisago Lakes Princeton game. The 4A team Princeton is 5-0. To start the football season for the first time since 2004 and play a tough Chisago Lakes team on Friday, October 6th.
I'm really happy with the spotlight game being Anoka Centennial. However, if I could have another choice, I would love it to be that Princeton-Chisago.
It's going
to
be a really good football game. Now, Princeton runs two different offenses. Both are effective. And I talked with their head coach, Ryan Fay, this week. The Princeton Tigers run two very different looking offensive packages. The wishbone offense or the gun with the quarterback away from the center. Either way, it's a run pass option offense that works.
What we really focus on is being able to execute the small things and winning those one-on-one battles and those two-on-two battles and making the correct reads so we don't put our players in tough positions where they have to be either outnumbered or run a play that's not going to work. So we have multiple plays called each time. It just happens to be that we keep it on the ground a lot, which I haven't been too upset with, which, you know, has played out in our favor.
Fair to say that this game Friday may be your biggest test yet?
Yeah, I think it would be. Wilmer was a great test for us as well. And we know moving forward that this type of game is the norm. We have a tough schedule to end here. We have a fantastic section coming up too. And, you know, this is the start of it all, really, in seeing these type of competitive teams that have had more success in the win column.
Kind of a sleeper in 4A. Everybody's talking about Becker. Everybody talks about Orne. Oh, they talked about Hutch until they've lost a couple, have had so many injuries. Detroit Lakes. I mean, Princeton's kind of the sleeper. Are you okay with that?
I am. I like to create our own path. Really, we haven't earned the respect yet. We really haven't. Those schools that you guys that you just talked about there have. They've had continued success and they've shown it in their seasons throughout the years. They've earned that, and we're big on that here, is earning it as well. So if we're a sleeper or whatever it is that you want to call us, we invite it.
So here's some numbers to throw at you. They average 334 yards rushing per game. They have 23 touchdowns on the ground. They've only thrown the ball 34 times. So my question to him is really RPO? I mean, but he says, yes, we do call a pass play on every play. It is the option for the quarterback to make that adjustment.
That last play did have a big play passing touchdown.
Right.
But this is interesting to me. Looking at that tape, the number of big play touchdowns from both formations, both the wishbone and the gun.
And you wouldn't think about the pass play from the wishbone. I'm sure they probably throw from that as well.
But the scary thing is they are obviously capable of doing it, but haven't needed to yet. I fear for future defenses.
Yeah, they may. They may have. They're going to be challenged. There's no doubt about it. By the way, when he's talking about interceptions, Craig, in their section, Becker and Ricori. So it's not an easy section by any stretch of the imagination. Nice. Let's finish up the rest of the football rankings released on Monday. Here's Class 4A. Princeton's number 6. Becker receives 9 first place votes. Orono's the new number 2 team with 1 first place vote. And Hutch falls all the way to number 8.
I'm really interested in the Byron Bears there at number 3. We haven't talked about them much on this show. And all they do is go out and outscore teams by a total of 222-21. That's all they do, Randy. 222-21. They just shut out Holy Family and their coaching triumvirate, 28-0.
They're a very good football team. They're located down by Rochester. 3A rankings, Dassel Cokato upset by Litchfield this last week. The Dragons with the win move up to number 5 in 3A. The new number 1 team is Stuartville, Esko's number 2.
After an opening week loss to Annandale, Litchfield has really gotten things together, especially noteworthy upending the number 1 team. And Stuartville,
The new number one team has outscored teams by a total of 233-29.
Very good football program. 2A rankings, Barnesville's number one. Chatfield and Caledonia will play each other. We'll have a matchup this week on Friday. That's going to be fun. St. Agnes beat Concordia Academy to win the Battle of Dale Street Trophy this last week.
I looked that up. That Battle of Dale Street Trophy is a cool-looking kind of crystal football, mildly similar to the NCAA National Championship Trophy.
The Aggies ranked number six. 1A, Mineota is the dominant number one team. 9 first-place votes. Fillmore Central moves up to number two. That's because Springfield got beat last Friday. Mayor Lutheran and Lester Prairie will square off against each other. Lester Prairie's ranked number 10 this week. Mayor fell out of the top 10.
Sleepy Eye caught Springfield napping and rested them down 16-14. To slumber their way to the number 5 spot.
And the nine-man rankings have defending state champ Mountain Iron Buell number 1 with 10 first-place votes. Fertile Beltrami moves up to number 2 after Spring Grove got beat this last week.
And our Mountain Iron colleague, George Marinzo, continues his chest pumping.
Yes.
He did warn me, though, about his concerns about the number 3 team, Cherry. He said they look tough. And George knows his nine-man.
He does know his nine-man. Well, the Twin Cities lucky to have prep sports beat writers who cover the games with passion, great passion. Jim Paulson is one of those guys. He works for the Star Tribune, and we talked recently about his job in Minnesota high school football. You've been doing this a long time. Has it changed a lot over the years in how you cover high school in Minnesota?
What's changed a lot has been the immediacy, I think, of what you do. It used to be a time when I could go to a game, I could stand on the sidelines, I could walk back and forth, I could get my interviews, then come back to the office and write it after a game. Now the immediacy of what you need to have. You need to have live scoring, you need to have tweets, you need to have social media, you need to have game stories written just minutes after the game is done. And then sitting in my car, writing a game story on a 15 or 20 minute deadline after the game. That's the thing, the immediacy and the quick turnaround is the biggest change.
The glamour of media, right?
Yeah. People tell me, you must have a great job because you get to go to the game. Yeah. And I always say, well, the games are fun, but it's after the game. That's when that work happens.
Favorite stadium to cover a game?
Ettinger Field in South St. Paul. It's built in kind of a natural bowl behind the old school, high school there. They've got a tunnel that goes out to the practice field before the game. The kids sit in stands that are built into the turf there, into the bowl there. So I love Ettinger Field.
Most enjoyable football player you've ever interviewed and why?
I really like Will Sather, the center at Eden Prairie this year. He's one of the reasons Eden Prairie I've got ranked number one, but he's intelligent, he's gregarious, he's a great wrestler as well. He's going to Princeton. He's a very smart kid, very easy to talk to. He's one of my favorite kids to talk to. If I need a quote from Eden Prairie, I'll look at Will.
One of the things that I find fascinating is how you decided to take over the football rankings. And I appreciate that. And for people who don't know, you took it upon yourself to kind of get this thing organized. Why do you think that's important? Why do you think football rankings for high school football is important?
I think rankings draw eyes. When the Associated Press decided they weren't going to do it anymore, I was kind of flabbergasting.
Exactly.
Because this is a chance for kids to get exposed and to get rewarded for excellence. And so I figured somebody needed to do it. And so I decided to do it, and it's been a lot of work, but it's been rewarding so far. The thing I love about Friday night is community. It's a chance for your entire area to come together, where you've got senior citizens who've been going to games for 50 years. You've got young kids who are out in the community and have a chance to get out and see their classmates in a non-school setting. You've got parents. It's a very social atmosphere. Everyone comes together to root on their team. And there are certain things I just love about Friday nights. My latest favorite has been watching these dance lines come out at halftime and bringing the little 5 and 6 year old and 7 year old girls with them. And it's the biggest thing in their life when they're out on the field. Some people are not looking, but I'm spending my time in halftime watching all these little girls trying to dance and be with the bigger girls, and how important it is to them on the Friday night lights to have their parents watching them. It's the biggest thing in their lives, and that's what makes football so great. It's one night, everybody comes together for the community to celebrate their area. I can't think of a better place to be on Friday night.
I appreciate Jim stopping by to talk a little bit. And just let me explain. He's taken over this rankings where there's like 12 of us who vote from across the state of Minnesota. But Jim is the one who takes all of our votes in and then ranks them. And that's what you see on Mondays. So we owe him a lot of thanks for taking on that job. And it is an important job. And I appreciate that.
Well, and thank you, Jim, for allowing me to stick a GoPro in your face. Also, I have a lot of empathy when he talks about, you know, we think about the glamour of covering all these right. great sports, but editing in your car on your laptop with like 20 minutes to go, the number of weird, difficult, and awkward spots I've had my laptop when I'm trying to edit on deadline.
You know what that's like.
I have not edited in a Portageon yet, and I don't intend to.
Well, let's hope not. All right, we've got our hot highlights this week.
Hot Highlights is sponsored by TrueStone Financial.
Watch the one-handed catch by Kaiem Blomquist of Becker. That is our first hot highlight of the week. Replay, great snag. That's hot highlight number one.
Hot highlight number two is a fabulously foreshadowing run by Liam Rogers of Orono as he breaks three tackles, cuts back and loose. Just a fantastic effort by Rogers. That's hot highlight number two.
And hot highlight number three is this strip of a kickoff return by Jaden Kinsel-Arredondo of Two Rivers and scores on the fumble return for a touchdown. And that's a big play for Highland Park, and that's hot highlight number three. You have all week to vote. Go to care11.com. I'll announce the winner on Friday in the Prep Sports Extra. Now it's time for our Weeble winner of the week.
Well, we just said fabulously foreshadowing for a reason.
Okay.
The quality of our Weebles have been ripe this season.
The Weebles wobble, but they don't fall down.
They don't fall down too easily. You'll see this week's play. Are you freaking kidding me?
Hey, hey, look at me and Weeble.
The best Weebles are the true tackle dodgers. This week's Weeble Award goes to Liam Rogers, Orono senior running back. He's number four, 5'9", 175. We're going to watch him. He's going to take a handoff. We're going to enjoy it a little bit first.
Oh,
bonk. We saw this on Hot Highlights, but oh, we're going to break this down a little further.
Oh.
Yeah, that's a nice effort.
Woo.
But the true reason why he gets the Weeble here, we're going to show again. Because
oh,
watch this. Number 78 is 285 pounds. Rogers is 175 pounds. That's a 110-pound difference that he just wrestles away like it's paper mache.
Yeah.
110-pound difference. I also want to point out something else here. Watch number nine on the tackle, Owen McHugh. He's going to shed Owen McHugh's tackle there, right? Well, Owen McHugh turns out to be a Weeble catcher. Those are a rare breed, too. Look, there he is, flat-footed.
No way. He's the guy that...
He's going to be 5, 6, 7 yards behind the play.
Oh, my goodness.
Rogers is loose. Watch the speed of the Weeble catcher. Nobody's going to get him, right?
Oh, my.
It's just like, whoosh.
That's a great play.
That is pretty incredible.
That saved a touchdown.
Yeah, that's pretty incredible. So congratulations to Rogers on the Weeble and McHugh to be the Weeble catcher.
Boy, well, I think the Weeble catcher is just as impressive this week as the Weeble winner.
Effort. It proves that you never give up on a play.
Wow.
Right? You go to the ground, you get up, you run.
Fantastic.
You follow a play. That's great.
That's the best breakdown
right
of a play I've seen all season long. That was really good. All right, thanks for watching. We do appreciate it. Prep Sports Extra, Friday night, 10:15 on Care, 11 o'clock on cable, YouTube, care11.com. Friday night, we'll be in Anoka. Thursday night, we're covering the Eden Prairie Minnetonka game. No stress. There's no stress here. We're all getting along just fine.
If we had a quarterback that could
get out of the pocket,
stop being a statue and get out of the pocket, it'd
we'll
move
see you
your
next
legs
week.
And get downfield.
We'll see you next week.
Ah!